Well, I am from Center for Ecological Sciences and also from Center for Sustainable Technologies at the Indian Institute of Science. I work with the spatial data, the remote sensing data. I am sure all of you know about spatial data. Is there someone who is not exposed to spatial data? Okay. You all know the remote sensing? Okay, these are the pictures of the Earth taken from the satellite platform. You know, now the camera is being used here. Now when you mount the camera on the aeroplane or on the satellite, it keeps revolving the Earth. When it revolves the Earth, we get the data. You know, every 24 or 30 days interval, we get the same location, the information, the data, which we have to interpret it. And now today, we have a last 4.5 decades data. From 1970 onwards, we have the data. We launched the satellites way back in 1973. There are different resolutions are there, the multi-resolutions. You have the spatial resolution, the varied spatial resolution, spectral, and of course the temporal resolution. Temporal is the with time. That means every 21 or 30 days interval, from 70 onwards, we have the data. Now I have used that data to understand the urban dynamics, intensities in India, and with the knowledge of that, we have tried to predict what is likely to happen in 2025 or 2035. And also, what are the environmental consequences of this kind of urbanization also we have looked at. So that is where we look at the consequences of unplanned urbanization. Okay, with this background, I will take up my discussion on the visualization of urban dynamics in India. So before that, since Professor Datta asked me to introduce myself, I work in Western Ghats. I work in Western Ghats. You know, this is one of the biodiversity hotspots. I was told there's someone from CES is here. Oh, okay, I have seen you, okay. So the Western Ghats is from 8 degrees to 22 degrees latitude. And also, when I work in Western Ghats, my understanding of the nature, I bring it to the lab, and my students convert that into technology. So apart from the understanding the dynamics, urban dynamics, etc., we also develop the technology, whether it's a rejuvenation of lakes in Bangalore or other part of the country, we have contributed in our own way. Okay? Now, before coming to the urban area, let us try to understand how the life is in Western Ghats. Okay? So my talk consists of three parts. In a 1 hour duration, I'm going to talk about 2-3 minutes about Western Ghats. Then I will talk about urban dynamics in India, the 10 cities. Then also I'll take up the discussion on industrial corridors. In fact, when Professor Datta invited me, she saw a paper on the industrial corridors. How the new corridors is likely to change the landscape in India. Now, why Western Ghats has to be conserved? If you look at the Western Ghats, the number of species, here the x-axis gives the latitude and the number of species. You will see the highest number of species occurs in 8 to 14 degree latitude. Now, this is the region corresponds to Kerala and Karnataka part of Western Ghats. That means we have highest number of species in this part of Western Ghats, and Western Ghats constitute only 5% of the entire India. And in that entire India, 5%, we are saying 40% is ecologically sensitive. You know, 40% of 5%, you know that how much it constitutes. It's not a big thing, but unfortunately, we are losing them. Now, you look at that nature is always in balance as long as humans are not there. That means when the anthropogenic pressure is not there. And what are the message from the nature? One is there is an energy and material transition happens and remediation. Nature has the ability to treat. You know, you will see someone washing the cloth in the river. The other end, people are collecting the water. But if you go and analyze the water samples from both the end, you will be surprised to see that water is treated by the time when it reaches. So that as the water moves, there is a treatment happens, okay? That we call it as remediation, and that phenomena is called bioremediation. And the next principle of nature is the sustainability. You know, renewability ensures the sustainability. You're all youngsters. As we fade away in the system, you will take over. That's how the the sustainability is ensured. Now, when we talk about development, you know, as long as you do not affect the livelihood of the people, I would say that is the development that India should take. Now, for example, if you look at this region, the development in the form of a train. The Konkan Railway was implemented, but it didn't deprive the local people of their right to live. The fish, the sand, salt, they continue to get. This is the kind of development path one should have. Now, let's look at how the nature works. Now, if you look at this one, I'm sure you all have studied this in the school days. This is the food chain. You see that food is produced, and it moves from one level to the other level. Then whatever is left is put back into the elemental form in the nature. That means there is nothing called waste in our natural system. But when we introduce the synthetic material, then you will have a heaps of waste. That's what is happening in the major cities in the country. Now, when we do not respect the nature, how we have to pay the price? You see, this is one of the examples how this island died. See, the water scarcity became the deciding factor, the Easter Island. The similar thing happens in Vijayanagara kingdom. The last leg of kingdom failed because of the water scarcity. That means whatever you do in the name of development, if you remove the water, then we are going to pay the price. The city will die. I won't be surprised in another 5 years if Bangalore dies. The way we are doing the mistake, I am sure that that is going to happen. Well, look at the way the Western Ghats, people are... See, this is a lady probably in the mid-50s. She goes under the water, spends few minutes, and collect a bucket full of bivalves. These are the organisms which have shells. So now when she collects a bucket full of bivalves, she earns 250 to 300 rupees every day, which is sufficient to meet her requirement for that day. But if you look at how the urbanites are, we do not want just 250 rupees. We go on extracting the resources. So that's the root cause of the problem. Now when you look at the urban area, what happens? Here you see the lady has to struggle, and she is exposed to pollutant, and in the process, the end of the day, she gets only 25 rupees, which is not sufficient to meet her own lunch. So this is not a development, okay? Now, I would say these are all the signs of unplanned development. When the city faces a flood, or the frequent tree fall, or the dumping of solid waste, and then liquid waste, not managing it, these are all the signs of unplanned urbanization. Now, let's understand what is urbanization. Now, I'll get into the second part of my talk. So, the urbanization, the increased urban population in response to the growth in urban areas is mainly due to migration and increased impervious surface. Now, increased impervious surface is like in the form of the building, roads, etc. This also helps us in identifying where all urbanizations happen, okay, using remote sensing data. Now, if you look at the country, the urban population in India is growing at around 2.3% per annum, and there are 48 urban cities in the country, and India has 4 megacities in the top 20 megacities in the world, as per the UN, okay? Now, when you look at the impervious surface, these are mainly the artificial structures such as building, pavements, the roads, sidewalks, etc. These features you are able to extract from the remote sensing data. So now India, if you look at the urban population, India is growing at 2.3%. And if you look at Karnataka, it's about 3.1%, much higher than the overall country. Okay. Now, if you look at the definition of the urban areas in the region, when the population of the region exceeds is 5,000 and 70% is the non-agriculture population, then we call that region as the urban area or the town. So now there are urban agglomeration, and when you see that when you do not plan the urban areas, what happens is, you know, there will be outgrowth in the outskirts of the cities. Normally, that region will not have the basic amenities and sanitation, the pipe, water supply, etc. In the process, you see that become unhygienic the situation. That is the need for planning. You know, you have to curtail the sprawling happening in the region. So that is where you need to intervene and do the planning. You have some doubts? Now, what are the factors that influence the urban area? Okay, economic, then political and social. Okay, then also the physical, the geography of a region. Okay, now when I take up the example of Bangalore, you will understand these parameters. Okay, now there are urbanization. There are two types. One is a planned urbanization and other one is unplanned urbanization. So planned urbanization in the form of township. For example, Chandigarh is a planned town, planned city. Okay, now unplanned thing is most of the other cities in the India are the unplanned one. You might see that initially the planning has happened, but subsequently the planning has failed there. So that is what is happening in Chennai, Bangalore, Mumbai, Delhi, etc. So now, you know, when you connect two towns by a road, okay, then what happens in between somewhere, you will see some tea shops will come. Then if you see after some time tea shops, you will have some service centers like bike centers, etc. Then it becomes a small town. Now this growth, the planner has to catch that, identify that, so that he or she can provide the basic amenities like drinking water, sanitation, etc. Now for that to happen, they should capture the growth. Now how to capture the growth? That is by the remote sensing data, you should be able to do that. That's what we have done for the couple of cities in the country. Okay. Now, the remote sensing data is the data about the Earth taken from the satellite platform. This is in the visible band and infrared band. Now, you are all looking at me. You are sensing me, what I am speaking, etc. That means that remote sensing is happening. Whatever I am saying will be in your brain probably till I leave the place. But if you want that for a longer time, you need to store, you archive it. That is where you use the cameras and record the event or the phenomena. Now, when you want to have the physical state of the region, you take you mount the camera on the aeroplane. As the aeroplane moves, you take the picture, you will know from time T1 to time T2, how the things have changed. With this knowledge, time T1 to T2, you should be able to tell time T3 or T4 what is the likely growth. That is what we have done. Now, there are two ways. One is we have looked at the agent-based modeling we have done, and also we have done the cellular automata also. You know, when you look at the remote sensing data, it is just a collection of grids. When you zoom your photograph, you know, passport size photograph, you will see it is a collection of the grids. Each grid is called a pixel or a picture element. Now each picture, the pixel has a number, which we call it as a spectral signature or a digital number. Now for the urban area, there is a cluster of numbers. For the vegetation, there's another cluster of number. Once you understand what is the number for that particular entity, you should be able to map and find out where all that particular entities are there. We do the classification of data, both supervised and unsupervised techniques. The unsupervised technique means you just say that, okay, there is a likelihood of 16 cluster, and then you allow the number to become form a 16 cluster. Then you will try to say that, okay, cluster 1 is this, cluster 2 is this, cluster 3 is this. The accuracy of that could be as low as 35 to 40%. Now, if you want the still better accuracy, you need to collect the data from the field. Now, the spatial data or the picture what you get, since they are geographically referenced, that means each and every pixel has the XY coordinate or the latitude longitude. Now, when you have the latitude longitude, I can find out where those heterogeneous patches or those patches which are different and get that polygon. Go to the field with the GPS, find out what that polygon is. This is the way we collect the training data. See, for example, you have the remote sensing data for the part of the Bangalore. This part of the Bangalore, where you have vegetation, where you have the built-up area, and also you have open area. Now, when you have the bands of data in the visible range, you know, you have green, red, and near infrared band, you generate a composite of that and assign the false color. When you do that, you can make out the heterogeneous patches. Then out of those, the entire study area, at least 15% of the area, you try to collect the field data. you know, 15% heterogeneous patches. We'll just draw the polygon, go to the field and collect the attribute information. With that knowledge, we come back and use the maximum likelihood classifier to classify the entire the image. So we extrapolate it. Then of course we do the accuracy assessment. We find out through the Kappa statistic, we would find out what is the agreement levels, etc. Okay? Okay, this I have explained. And you know, I said that modeling, we have both tried both non-agent and also the agent-based modeling. So we try to understand what is the current status, what is the earlier status. With that knowledge, we try to estimate the future status, okay? So this publication is available online. You can download and you can read that. So now when you look at the cells, these have the either the 0 or 1. You know, the behavior of the cell depends on the neighborhood. Okay, that is what we try to understand, and if the time permits, I'll get into the details of that at the latter part of my talk. So now, when you look at the cellular automata, it's a model of a system of cell objects with the following characteristics. The cells live on a grid, and each cell has a state, and the number of state possibilities is typically finite, either 0 or 1. Since you are interested in capturing the urban dynamics, you will make it all the urban area 1, and other areas the zero. Okay. Now each cell has a neighborhood. Now, depending on the kind of neighborhood, you know, suppose if there is a water body, we assume that it will not change. Or if there is a protected area, we assume there won't be any change. For example, if there is a campus like Indian Institute of Science or Lal Bagh or Kappan Bagh, we put the constraint as that it will not going to change. So, and if there are some vacant land or the other kind of thing, we say that there is a probably higher probability of the change. Okay, now we understand we have the transition function. Okay, now if you look at the CA Markov chain analysis involves the defining the transition rule set and obtaining the Markov probabilities, calibrating these rules, validation of the results, and projecting the land use changes in 2020. Okay, now the transition rules are a set of rules that govern the state of change of the pixel that influence the neighborhood. Now, calibration involves the calibration of variables involved in obtaining the transition, the potentials. Now, when you look at this one, see, we have even tried the agent-based modeling. So now what, this one, we have looked at what are the agents. Now, what I'll do is I'll skip a couple of slides. I'll come to these slides after some time and give the example and then get back to the theory after some time, okay? Okay, now when you... The analysis, what we have done, we have acquired the data, both the remote sensing data and the field data, and we have done the pre-processing. When you get the remote sensing data, you need to check for its integrity. That means you will do the geometric correction and radiometric correction, and then you will do the classification of the data, that is the analysis. As I explained earlier, we use the maximum likelihood classifier. Then, of course, we interpret that. Now, when you have this data at a various time interval, you have a temporal data. Now you can understand the dynamics of that. Now that is what we have done. Then we try to understand the agents that is responsible for the change, the behavior of the agent, extent of the agent. With that knowledge, we try to project what is likely to happen the 5 years down the line or 10 years down the line. Now these are the 10 cities we have looked at. The Delhi, Bhopal, Calcutta, Ahmedabad, and in southern India, these are the 4 cities we have looked at. Now, when you look at Bangalore, you see that Bangalore, which was from 1973 to 2010, if you look at how the green has changed. Green is the tree cover, the red is the urban area, that is a paved surface, blue is the water body, and yellow is the open space, okay? Now, this gives you the number. See, 7.97 built up in 73, become 52% in the 2010, okay? Now, see, what we did is, we took Bangalore along with a 10-kilometer buffer to understand whether there is any, the influence of Bangalore on the surrounding area. These are the urban area. So that if not today, 10 years down the line, there will be the thing. That is where you need to keep in mind which part of Bangalore is growing fast and what kind of amenities have to be provided. That is where this modeling and understanding of the data, behavior of the data, and all these things are helpful. Okay? Now, this gives you the land use dynamics. the regular interval. Now I have the data. I know the behavior of the data with reference to the time. Now I should be able to tell what is likely to happen the later the stage. Okay. Now this is what we published some time back, the using cellular automata calibration model. We try to understand the urban growth. As I said earlier, these are cells and we understand the behavior of the cells. CA is based on the pixels, states, neighborhood and transition rules. That means how one pixel is changing from one state to the other, we try to understand. And what is the factor that is responsible for the change? Okay. Now, the CA model or the urban growth, the design of CA algorithm involves defining the transition rules, calibrating these rules, evaluating the results. The transition rules identify the neighborhood needed for the tester cell to urbanize. Now, when you look at this carefully, if test pixel is water, road, or urban, then there is no change. I said that we assume that water body is not likely to be removed. But of course, in Bangalore, that is changing. Okay. If test pixel is non-urban, that means vegetation or open land, then it becomes urban. It is likely to become urban. So if it's then population density is equal or greater than the threshold and neighboring residential pixel count is equal or greater than the threshold, then there are chances of the urbanization. Now, when you look at this, this is the earlier Bangalore. You know, today Bangalore has become greater Bangalore. The area of Bangalore earlier was about 320 square kilometer. Today, it is about 740 square kilometer. This is from 1973 to 2010, when you look at the way this is 2006, from 2007, we had the Bangalore expanded to the greater Bangalore, okay? Now, we divided Bangalore into 8 zones, and we try to understand how the urban growth is happening. This gives you an idea which direction it is changing and why it is changing. Is it because of the industries coming up there or it is because of some other factor, the institutions that are there in that region, whether it's because of that the urban growth is happening. So now you can see that the different region, the land use with that the urban growth, okay? Then we have the population density, the distance, you know, each zone we divided further into the smaller pocket. Then each pocket we try to look at what is the population density and the distance from the core center we try to look at and how that varies from the distance from the center, the population density we try to look at it. Okay, now we have the data for the population or the population density for the 70, yeah. Sorry? You didn't understand which part. Okay. See, here, what we did, we divided Bangalore into 8 zones. Okay. Now, there is a wards. You know, the Bangalore has further divided into wards. Each ward has the population data. Now, that population data is available. This one. Now, I compute the population density because I know the area of the polygon and also the population. Once I have the population density, then from the center of this one, how that population density varies as you go. Whether at the core area there is a population or this one, what is the kind of the dynamics? Whether it's a linear or whether it goes and comes back like this, you know, whether it is becomes a parabola kind of thing or this one, we try to look at it. Once you understand that behavior, for you to model, it becomes easier. That's what we have done that, okay? So now these are the various sub-regions we took it for this one, and we try to understand how this urbanization has happened, and then with that knowledge we try to project it. Okay, so now see, when we project, actually what we do is for the known year we project it first. You know, for example, if I have a data from 1973 to 2010, okay, I'll project it for 2012 and 2014. And the advantage of doing that is I have the actual data of 2012 and 2014. I can compare the simulated data with the actual growth. Okay? If that is how I do the accuracy assessment. Okay? Once I see that accuracy is high, I use this to project the 2020 or 2025, which may be correct, may not be correct. It has to be correct because I have captured the earlier behavior. Okay? Okay, now I will not get into the details of this. Now, I have talked about this validation of modeling techniques. See, what we have done is, we have CMRCO, we have done the actual and the predicted thing. we saw that what is the kind of thing, 29.33, and the predicted is 30.21. That is a slight overshoot is there, okay? So now the geomod is another modeling technique. The considering the geological parameter, we have done that. Again, we see that this, here, since we have considered the agent, the modeling is, seems to be quite robust, okay? Then we have the land change modeler. This I didn't discuss, but this also, if you look at the this one, you see that 29.33 and 31.19. There is a large variation, okay? Now, with that, we predicted for 2020 with a 5% population growth. See, here we have considered the population as the agent of change, okay? Then LCM, based on the land users, we have predicted. What is the likely this one? And we also tried fuzzy AHP, the CO, CIA Marco. So I'll come to the details of that after some time, okay? Now, actual is 29.33 and predicted is 30.2 in this, okay? Now, we have the, with that, we try to, you know, every city, they have the CDP, the city development plan. If you follow the city development plan, what is the kind of growth you are likely to have? If you don't follow it, what is the likely thing? We have tried to predict that also. Of course, there is not much variation in the both the output. 57.58 without the CDP, and with CDP it is 57.79%, okay? Now, CMRCO 2020, this is the likely, this one, 70% is the in 2020, okay? This is, you know, this is the work which we did about the 8 or 9 years back. Now, today growth, if you look at, see how the changes have happened and how far our modeling approaches we have to fine-tune it, you will try to get a picture, okay? Now, I'll come to the next part where we did the density is this one. That is, during this decade, we have done the analysis. You know, those who are in Bangalore, who are from Bangalore, will know that in 1800, this region had 1,452 water bodies and 80% was a green cover. And the advantage of that was during the May month, the temperature in the city was about 14 to 16 degrees Celsius. And today, the same city in the month of March itself, you see that temperature of 37 to 38 degrees, okay? Now, the city which was a garden city became a garbage city and today is a dead city, okay? Now, this is how the Bangalore is, how it looks, okay? And you see that how the city is expanding. Now, earlier, you know, surrounding villages was about 50 kilometers. Eventually, it became 10 kilometers. Today, it's almost 1 kilometer. Or maybe that the village itself will be swallowed by the Bangalore. Okay? Now, these are some of the one in Bangalore. Okay. Now, when you look at the topography of the Bangalore, you know, all these things, when you look at it, there is a number associated with this. You should... That as the people work with this thing, you should know that, okay? This gives the digital elevation model. This has the elevation value. Now, when you look at, when I use that 3D of that, I'll get an idea about undulations in the region. Now, taking advantage of undulations, our earlier generation had created the interconnected water bodies. That's how we had 1,452 water bodies. And today I have about 193 water bodies. 1,452 in 1800. Today it's about 193 water bodies. Okay? Now look at the way that things are changing. See, these are from the actual, this one data. As on date, I have the data. When you look at this carefully, you know, 1970, we launched the satellite, we have the data. From 1970 to today, every 21 or 30 days interval, you have the data. Now, 68% green cover in 70s. Today, if you look at 81% is the red. Red is the urban area or the paved surface, etc. See, now, last about 2 years back, is about 78%. At that time itself, I said Bangalore is dying. But now you say that 2019, it's already 81%. You all know that for any city to survive, there should be adequate oxygen and water. The oxygen comes from the green cover. Now, as per the norm, we are supposed to have 33% green cover in any region. But unfortunately, when you see that, what is the green cover we have today? Okay? Now, let's just animate this and show you this. 1973, when I was a child, you see the Bangalore was garden city and green was there. Then 92, see with the industries coming up in Peenya and Koramangala, you see the changes happening there. Now you also understand the agents. The extent of change also you get. Now 2000, in the outskirts, we had a IT BT. Now you see the another agent, because of the large scale implementation of the IT-BT sector, how the things have started changing, okay? Then 2006, you see the intensification of the urban area. 2009, now the 2017, 78%. And of course, 2019, you saw the 81%, okay? Now, with this one, you see that 1,028% increase in the built-up area. We have lost 88% vegetation and 79% of the water body. In fact, that is where my one article titled was Enough is Enough. You know, when you write such article with a simple words like enough is enough, I have noticed that people do not read. Okay? Then I wrote the next article to say what is going to happen to the Bangalore in 2020 and 2025. So for that, we did the modeling and visualization. See, for that, I divided Bangalore into four zones, 1 kilometer concentric circle. In each circle, how the growth happens and what are the agents? We try to understand that. Now, with that, we predicted 2020, what is the likely growth? Now, when I look at the thing, of course, I wrote an editorial in the Current Science also, saying that Bangalore is becoming unlivable, okay? Then most of these national dailies and regional papers took my article, and it became a front, the first page article only. But I noticed that majority of the Bangaloreans have not still got the message. When I talk to the people, they are not even aware about Bangalore, what is happening. So they think that having IT-BT and earning is a good thing in the Bangalore, but they do not know the other side of the Bangalore. So then I was thinking what needs to be done. So that's where I wrote a next article saying that Bangalore is dying, is a dead city. So then one of my students realized my concern. He said, sir, don't worry. This time we will not put it in the newspaper. Let us put it on the other mode. That's where he put it on the Facebook. All the faceless fellows looked at it and they become so concerned. They said, I thought, okay, I have achieved the success now. But I thought that success was only for 3 days. Then after 3 days, all the fellows have gone back to their own boroughs, okay? Now, my concern is, the Bangalore, 94% of landscape getting concretized by 2020. And 98.5% would be concretized by 2025. Only the places like IISc, Lal Bagh, Kabban Park will be the lung space of the city. That is where is the worrying thing. The city is a knowledge city. There is a lot of knowledge is there. We are giving a lot of input. But where are the people to take this for the policy making and the decision making? Okay? So one of the things I've been talking is the decongest Bangalore. Okay? Now, what are the implications of the thing? Decline of oxygen level, groundwater table is declining, and it's getting contaminated. If you look at the situation in Bangalore, number of cancers have gone up. Kidney failures are increasing. The kidney failure, which is 1 in 1 lakh, about 10 years back. Today, my data shows it's 1 in 5,000. And every ward in Bangalore has the dialysis unit. Now, the day is not far off. If this trend continues, every house may have to have a dialysis unit. And probably your grandchildren, when they start going to the school, you may have to have an instrument which is connected to their body so that the dialysis happens, the thing. That is the level of the thing we are reaching, okay? So now, how many trees are there in Bangalore? We, again, through the pattern classifiers, we tried to this one. What did we do? This is my campus, 400 acres. Using GPS, we did the mapping of the entire campus. I know what kind of species are there, where it is. Now, similar exercise, we did it in a couple of wards. Now, I have a remote sensing data with a higher spatial resolution for the entire Bangalore. The resolution of 2 meter I have, which is sufficient to capture the canopy of a tree. See, when you take a photograph of a terrain, you get the canopy of a tree. Okay, you should use that canopy, that circle or polygon, to map the trees. That's what we tried to do it. And now with the knowledge of the training data, we did the classification of this thing. And I found that there is a 1.5 million trees are there for a population of 9.5 million the Bangalore. Now, that may, for every 7%, there's one tree. Now, you might ask, how many trees we require? We all give out carbon dioxide. I have not come across any individual who gives oxygen. Am I right? Except the vegetation. Even the vegetation in the evening, we do not get oxygen, okay? So now, we give out carbon dioxide to an extent of about 540 to 980 grams per person per day. And 1 hectare of tree removes the carbon to an extent of about 6 to 8 tons. By that ratio, for every person, the 7 or 8 trees are required. But what we have in Bangalore is 7% one tree. The trees of Bangalore, there is an article or a report on the webpage of my group, so you can download that, okay? Both in Kannada and English is available. Now, next is the lakes in Bangalore. So, I have already talked about it. See, when people created the lake, the storage capacity of this water body was 35 TMC. You know, that could address the Bangalore's, the earlier Bangalore, the irrigation requirement, the domestic water requirement, at the same time flooding. You know, this region of 741 square kilometer receives the rainfall of about 700 to 850 millimeter, which is about 15 TMC. But our earlier generation had created a water body which could hold the water 35 TMC. But today's generation, no, they do not even want to have 15 TMC of lake space. They want to swallow as many as possible. Okay? Now, lakes are being misused. See, the solid waste is dumped. You see the people encroach, the apartments come, and you know, the sewage gets into the thing, industrial effluent gets in, and those who are away, they send it through the tankers. So that way, whether you are close by or this one, everyone is polluting the water bodies. Now, the water body, when it is clean, it looks like this. When it's contaminated, it is surrounded by this one. When this happens, you know, thick, the water hyacinth grows. These are invasive species. It doesn't allow the sunlight to penetrate. When there is no sunlight, the lake will die. So that's what is happening in the Bangalore. Now we try to look at, if the lake is not polluted, what is the worth of it? If lake is polluted, what is the worth of it? So we found that people have benefited to an extent of 10,500 rupees per day per hectare if the lake is not polluted, because they get fish, fodder, etc. But when we pollute the lake, people lose the fish, the fodder, etc. And the value comes down to 20 rupees per day per hectare. Okay. Now, these are the classic photographs of the Bangalore. You know, for some people, this has become a selfie spot. For me, this shows the pathetic status of the Bangalore. You know, the frothing or the fire. See, I have traveled many countries in the globe. Nowhere people have shown me a coexistence of fire and water, except Bangalore. Okay, this is because of industrial pollution, and this shows that because of the detergent, you know, used in the industries as well as the home sector, which has a phosphorus, because of that we have the frothing happening. Of course, I have written to the government asking for the restriction of the phosphate used in the detergent. The government has told me that they look into it. For the government to look into my article itself will take almost a year. Now the new government has come. I have to see whether, again, the same thing I have to rewind, okay? Now, when we contaminate the water body, what happens? So, you see that every unit of pollutant getting into the water body, it gets magnified in the fish to the 1 million times. The phenomena is called bioaccumulation. The fish eats many algae and it goes on eating every day. So that means you are collecting the fish which has those heavy metal, okay? Now, people are growing vegetable in the downstream. I have collected the samples of both fish, the vegetable and the groundwater. I found that all these have heavy metals. You know, having heavy metal in the food, is it good or bad? So, that's where we are paying in the form of the kidney failure. Now, other part is, we are also contributing to the warming of the earth. You know, the amount of greenhouse gases is increasing in the region. You know, whether it is because of the vehicular pollution or we have done the study for the 10 cities. Now, when you look at the 10 cities, all are equally bad. Whether it's Delhi, Mumbai, Chennai or Bangalore, we are in the same order. First is Delhi and the fourth position is the Bangalore. Now, if you look at Bangalore carefully, there's something interesting. You know, the transportation sector, the cities where public transport is weak, you see the emission is higher from the transportation sector. It is as high as 43% in Bangalore and 54% in Hyderabad. Now, for the planning, these are the things you have to give the inputs. Now, you see the architecture that is being adapted in the Bangalore is like this. This architecture is for the temperate climate where you have to conserve the heat. You know, the building with a glass facade will conserve the heat. But unfortunately, our fellows copied that architecture and pasted in Bangalore, Hyderabad and Mumbai environment. Now, the implication of that is to understand that we took the samples in Bangalore, you know, about 2,000 samples. We looked at what is the electricity consumption in the houses where there are no glass facade versus the houses where there are glass facades are there. This is surprising and revealing information for us. In a normal houses, if the electricity consumption is 750 to 1,700 units per person per year, it becomes the 14,000 to 15,000 the units per person per year. You know, almost 10 times higher electricity consumption just because of one mistake of poor, inappropriate architecture. Now, higher the electricity consumption means, higher is the greenhouse gas. Higher the greenhouse gas means you are contributing to the warming of the earth. The implication of that is you have the flooding, the changes in climate, and those implications, okay? So, now, the other implication is the temperature. Now, again, when you have the remote sensing data, you can capture the temperature of the region. You know, there are thermal sensors in the wavelength of 9.7, you can find out what is the land surface temperature. So we use that data, and of course we validated that with the ground data, and then we have used that for further analysis. Now when we have this data, you know, from the center of the city we moved in 8 direction, and every pixel, how the things behave, if it is the water body or the vegetation or the building, how it varies. Now you see that wherever the lakes or the vegetations are there, temperature is at least 2 degrees lower. Okay. Now again, this data is available for the last 4.5 decades. If you want to do the analysis of this kind, you should be able to do, and you can analyze the trends, etc. Okay. Now you see my campus is also pretty cool. That's because of the kind of green cover and the water body we have in the campus. Okay. Now I share the other cities, the Delhi. We have looked at how again, what we did for Bangalore, the same thing we have done for the 10 cities in the country. Some of the results I'll try to share. And also now I'll give you the further insights on the modeling. So now this gives you the 70s, 80s, 90s and 2000. What is how the Delhi has grown? Delhi with a 10 kilometer, the buffer, okay? Now, to understand the further, we divided into 4 zones and 1 kilometer concentric circle. And then we try to look at what is the kind of the growth that is happening in the region. And we computed other landscape metrics. In each of these zones, we computed number of patches, edge density, then other parameter like NLSI and all those things. Okay. So now we try to understand the dynamics of that, how it changes. As we move from the center to the outskirts, how the things happens in the 4 zones. These are the 4 zones, how it changes from the time T1 to T2. Once you have this behavior known, you should be able to tell what is likely to happen tomorrow or day after tomorrow. Okay? Now, these are the megacities and its pattern of urbanization. These are the other cities we have looked at. Mumbai, Chennai, and Coimbatore, Pune, Chennai, then Hyderabad and Ahmedabad. So, and we have the other thing. You are most welcome to download this article. These are all available in my webpage and also in the research gate. All these articles are available, okay? Now, when we have tried the fuzzy analytical hierarchical CM model, okay? Now, when you look at the fuzzy and the AHP were introduced to understand the behavioral agent and its contribution to the development. So now, fuzzy sigmoidal monotonically increasing or decreasing functions were mainly used to understand the extent or influence of the agents, and AHP was used to rank each agent or parameter. Now, what are the agents? One is location of industry. How many industries are there? Then how close the region is from the road or the other education institution, etc. Then output of AHP with constraints were used in multi-criteria evaluations to derive the transition included in the CA. Okay? Now, these are the factors of the constraint we have used. The distance from the road, distance to the industry, bus stop, railway stations, from metro, then educational institution, population density, and city developmental plan, water body, defense regions. Defense regions will not change. In Bangalore, you have some pocket. Since they are under defense, I do not see much change happening. But now with the road widening, some changes are happening in Bangalore. Okay? Now, see, look at this one. This is a digital elevation model. This is a road, then drainage network, Then you have the site suitability, this one, for the urban land use, and also the criteria with the CDP and no CDP. Because CDP will tell which are the region to be conserved or in no development. Now, with development, without development, what is the thing? Well, those constrained regions, we have drawn the polygon here. Now, that has been accounted for the modeling. Okay? Then we have simulated that. You know the actual as well as the predicted. Now, both when you do the Kappa analysis, Kappa statistics, when you generate, if it matches, you know, if you get a Kappa of 0.8 or 0.9, you can go ahead with the further modeling. Okay? Now, with that, we predicted 2017. Again, 2017, we compare with the actual one. Then 2024. Okay? Now, this is for the Mumbai. From Delhi, we moved to the Mumbai. Again, we have predicted with the same strategy, 2020 and 2031. Then Chennai, 2026, and this is Coimbatore, 2023 and 33, we have done the modeling. Then Pune, okay. Now, the last part of my talk is the industrial corridors. You know, now the government of India, after the last regime, 2014 onwards, they decided to have the major corridors, industrial corridors. You know, the two cities are connected by this, and most of the industries will be located in that corridor, okay? Now, to see that, what is the likely impact of that on the local ecology and environment, we try to understand. We have picked up two corridors, Mumbai-Pune Express Highway and Chennai-Bangalore-Mangalore corridor, okay? Now, what are these corridors, if you look at? They have the high volume transport route and also have the linear mixed land use of urban industries and some amount of agriculture. The industries are set up in the corridor. See, now otherwise what will happen? Industries will come inside the village. Now you are putting it on the road itself so that, you know, the movement of the vehicle and cargo is easier. At the same time, the village, whatever the produce they produce, then come to the industries in their locality only. This development is also called cluster-based development. Actually, if they plan it properly, this is one of the important things that the country is going to be benefited. But unfortunately, land mafia always distorts that. So that is where we have to be careful on that, okay? Now, industrial corridors help to optimize the present potential and enhances the investment and also helps to promote the economic development of the region. Then in the 2014-15 Union Budget, Government of India has launched the five major industrial corridors which have been identified to provide a boost to the industrialization and planned urbanization in the country. These projects have been identified and are expected to be the key economic drivers for increasing the share of manufacturing in India's GDP. So then a National Industrial Corridor Development Authority is established to incorporate and systemize the development in the industrial corridors. Now these are the major industrial corridors. Now this kind of study, of course, help the decision makers or equip the decision maker so that he or she can decide which part of the corridor they have to be extremely careful, which part of the corridor they can have the aggressive land use change, okay? So now, see, the objective of this study was to understand what is the land use. The past 4 decades data we have analyzed. Then the quantitative analysis, urban expansion pattern using the landscape metrics, like I talked about those number of patches, edge density, and all those, the spatial metrics we use. Then we modeled and predicted the likely land use structure in 2021 and 2027. Okay? Now, this is Mumbai-Pune corridor, and its length is about 94 kilometers. It connects the industrial hub Mumbai with the education hub of Pune, and 4 districts are the linked in this. Okay? Now, the next corridor which we took for the study was Chennai-Bangalore-Mangalore. It connects the east and west coast. That means both Bay of Bengal is connected to the Arabian Sea. So that, you know, the idea is the cargo movement. So when you connect it, you know, the material from the other countries can come to the inland. At the same time, what we manufacture can we get an export boost, okay? There are 15 districts are covered in the two states, okay? Now we followed the same, land use, land cover analysis we did. Then we did the modeling with the AHP, okay? Now, what we did is, first is we did the field data collection. See, the strength of my work is my students who go and collect the field data. Of course, I also spend some time with them. So, we have at the regular interval, we have collected the field data. that knowledge of the field helped in classifying the remote sensing data. Now, once I understand the pattern of the in the remote sensing data, I can project it what is likely to happen. Okay, now from Mumbai to Pune, these are the various, this one where the corridor passes. Similarly, Mangalore to Chennai, we had a similar, the field survey. Once we start, you know, the whole journey might take about a week or about 10 days, but we would have covered the entire stretch, okay? So now, these are the various locations we have looked at with the districts. Now, when you look at the land use, land cover, see, 97 to 2015, you see how the vegetation is changing. Of course, red is the urban pockets. Then we also looked at the land use. See, land cover gives you the green versus non-green. That means you can say the vegetation versus non-vegetation. Land use will tell you, in the green, how much is forest, how much is agriculture and horticulture. Now, that also we try to do it. When you have to do that classification, your training data is going to help you. So that is what we do that. See, what we did is, in this corridor, there is a corridor, is a linear corridor. The width is about, maybe the maximum is about 30 meter. Okay? Now, on either side of the corridor, we have taken 5 kilometer by 5 kilometer buffer. Okay? And the entire stretch we have done. So now when you look at this stretch, this is 10 kilometer and this is the entire corridor. So we have captured. Because when you have the linear thing, there will be changes on the sides also. So you need to capture that, okay? And 10 kilometers is reasonably big area. Because I have done the study for the smaller corridors earlier. With that knowledge, we have tried to predict this, okay? Now, this gives you the extent of vegetation and other land uses in the region from 97 to 2015. Now, this gives you Chennai to Mangalore, the land cover, green versus non-green. Okay, that is using NDVI, we do that. And then this gives the land use, okay, in the region. You see the Bangalore, the getting urbanized Chennai, and this is the Mangalore. So it connects the Mangalore port with the Chennai port via the Bangalore, Tumku, Hasan, etc. Okay, now this gives you the extent of vegetation and the other land uses in the region. Then what we did is, when we have the corridor like this, we divide this into 25 kilometer. That means each block is 25 kilometer with a 10 kilometer. In each of those region, we have calculated the spatial metrics, okay? Like number of patches, edge density, etc. Okay? Now, that's what we have done. And how it is changing in various location, we have tried to this one. This is available online. You can download this, the spatial information. The journal has published that. I think you should be able to download and read that article. Otherwise, also in a research gate, it's available. Okay? Then similar thing, we did the study for the Chennai, Bangalore, Mangalore. See, once you understand this, the modeling is not difficult for you. So you know how the agents are behaving, what is the cause and effect on the ground, okay? Then the features contributing to landscape changes, we have looked at, you know, the slope, elevation, CDP, water bodies, etc. So as I said earlier, we have taken that into the account for both the regions. And then we use the AHPCA Markov chains, okay? Now, fuzzy logic is necessary to bring all the data to a common normalized format. Normalizes the data as binary or 8-bit using the monotonically increasing or decreasing or other mathematical functions or conditions. In the current study, distance from the future and land use are considered for normalizing the data. Then pairwise multi-criteria evaluation, that AHP process is also adapted. It is used to derive the weights for each of the features contributing to the landscape change. And each factor is compared against the other with respect to the influence of the land use and analysis. Then correlation analysis is done to derive the eigenvalues. Okay. So now you have the mathematical part of it. So these are detailed in the paper. You can look at it. Okay, now we have the site suitability for each of the, this one, Mumbai, Pune, and Chennai, Bangalore. Okay, then we have the simulation. As I said, first we simulate for a known year, compare with the actual growth. Then with that knowledge, if we have done a good job, if we have got a better accuracy, we project it for the unknown years, like 20, 25, 20, 30, like that. Okay, now 2015 is known because I have the actual growth and also the simulated. Because I have done the data from the 90s to 2015. So now I can with that knowledge, I have simulated for 2015. Now that I compare with the actual, okay? Similar thing we did for the Chennai, Bangalore, 2014, and compare that with the, see, sometime when you use the remote sensing data, you also face some problem like a cloud cover. You know, when the sun ray comes down and hits the ground, whatever is reflected is captured in the sensor. Okay? Now, that means we are using the solar energy electromagnetic spectrum. So now this electromagnetic spectrum get affected because of the, you know, the cloud particles and other dust particles in this one. That's why whenever we try to get the data, we make sure as much as possible there are no cloud cover or less than 5% cloud cover. So less than 5% is a worst scenario. Zero is the best scenario for us. And that's what we do it. See, now, for example, to put the things in simpler words, when you look at outside, the leaves looks green. Why it looks green? Because when the solar energy falls on the vegetation, during photosynthesis, the energy in the blue and red band are absorbed by the leaves and green is reflected. Depending on the amount of energy reflected in the green band, your eye perceives the vegetation as green. Okay? The same thing we have used in this analysis. You know, the spectral, we say the different colors, that's how we have the blue, green, red and infrared bands of data. Okay? Now, we have predicted 2021-2027. And that means we are hoping that this is the period they are going to implement it. Now, we are equipping the decision maker with this kind of knowledge so that if there are some corrective measures are required, they can implement it. See, 20 years back, no one had done this kind of study. The mistakes happened. Now, with this kind of study, if still mistakes happen, then we cannot do much, okay? Okay, this is Chennai, Bangalore. You see 2019, 2024, 2029, okay? So we have this one. So this gives the overall picture, okay? How the growth is going to happen, and we have also presented in various forms, okay, for both the corridors. Now, this is the last part. Should I stop now? Or can I take another 5 minutes? Sorry? 5 minutes, that's all. Because some signal. Okay. Actual talk I have completed, okay? So now what I am doing in Karnataka and other parts of the India, I'm going to share. One of the things is I have a network of institutions in India, the education institutions, schools and colleges. I have the environment education program. Okay? So, and also I organize a symposium which is popularly known as a lake symposium that I started in 98. Every even year I am conducting it. Uniqueness of this event is one day is for the school and college students to come and do the presentation. But they will attend all the 3 days event. So when they attend, they get an opportunity to interact with the experts. And also the concluding day when they do the presentation, the confidence goes up. So that's how the students who took part in my program, today they have become faculty in IITs and other places. So this is the kind of the capacity building happens. And also, if possible, create new lake. We have been doing it. And also plant native sapling. Now, when you come to IIC campus, this is what I have done it into the 2008. You know, what are the campus water? I have directed to the one place. So I have the water body. Now, when you look at one end, I have been grumbling that Bangalore is dying and other end. At the other end, I'll show you the pleasantness of Bangalore also. So look at this. Who are all enjoying this, the environment? I don't know whether you have gone to this place. Have you gone to this place? No. Okay. But certainly these animals are there. Okay. These are otters. I have a pair of them in the thing. Now if the otter is there in that the region, that must be getting enough food. I'm not taking any food and feeding it. So now we try to look at the diversity of life there. That's what two of my students did that. See, this 2005, you can see me taking measurement. 2008 onwards, how the water body looks you have. This is the algae. This is zooplankton. These are fishes in this one. Okay, and this is a bird in that region. That part of the campus, we have the highest number of species of birds. Okay, now you have the otter. And also I have a large number of the snakes. You know, recently one of my students got me a skin of the snake. We are all, engineers and scientists. We only believe numbers. We asked him to measure. He said it is 279 centimeters. Then we asked him to find out what is the maximum length that is reported in the country for that particular species. He said for the Najada, the maximum is 240 centimeters. So my campus, my institute is number one in the country. It's because of our students. Not only students excel in the campus, even the animals in the campus also excel. Okay? So that is on the other side of this. Okay? Now, I said that what I learned from the nature, I put it in the field. So that has become successful. This is the model. I have put it in Jakur. You know, the secondary treatment plant is there. It does the wastewater treatment, but it doesn't remove the nutrient. See, when you look at the sewage, what you generate at home, it has got a chemical ion and the nutrients like N and P. Now, secondary treatment plant will remove only chemical ion. Primary treatment will remove the large particle. And the tertiary treatment removes the nutrient. Nobody wants to have the tertiary treatment because it's very expensive, electricity and all those things. Now, what I did is, I just mimicked the nature. I passed it through the bed of plants, which have the ability to take the N and P, and then algal pond. By the time when it passes through these two and comes to here, 85% or 90% of the nutrient is removed. This article is available online. Those who are interested can go there. This is, I implemented in 2008 when I was a member of the committee. And this is the only model in the entire country or probably in the globe is a success model. That too in a country like ours, if something is successful, you should really say it is successful. Because if once we show the success model, there are 10 fellows to prove that it is not successful, okay? But now everyone is talking about this model, okay? And the next one, you know how the simple technology helps. This is a pond in the Gokarna, you know, religious place, Koti Tirtha, and it was stinking. And there's a profuse growth of invasive species. Now, the local people approached us, and government wanted to spend 15 lakh to rejuvenate the lake, this pond. Now, we went and we looked at the water quality. We found that water, when we analyzed the water quality, it is because of the organic input. Now, how the organic input comes to this water body? Because people perform the rituals. You know, the 14th, 12th day and anniversary, the rice balls and the other items, they leave it in the water body. Now, I cannot stop this practice. Now, I took advantage of this practice. What did I do? I just had a meeting with a priest. We had an understanding that they have to make sure that these rice balls, etc., are disposed at a particular location. When it is disposed, this priest had to chant and collect 20 or 25 rupees per family. Now, in the process, I have a revenue model where I get 20 to 25,000 rupees every month. That 20, 25,000, we give it to an NGO, which has hired three youths. Their job is to remove the excess rice ball from here, take it to the goshala and give it to the cattle, and do the de-weeding regularly. You know, every alternate day they have to do the de-weeding. Now the water body which was like this, last 2.5 years it looks like this. You know, the Lord Shiva got the water to the land, but he was taking the bath of this water. Now he must be happy because he is getting a clean water. In the meanwhile, I also introduced a fish which eats rice. You know, there's a species of fish, mahasher, which is the... See, that is my ecological engineering. Now, fish does the job of treatment, and the youth have got the job, job as well as the livelihood is taken care. At the same time, the cattle is also, gorakshas are also happy. So that means I have tried to keep everyone in the happy condition with this model, okay? And what is the amount I spend? 15,000, that's my travel and the cost of the fish and my students' travel and the food, okay? Now, that means with a simple intervention, you should be able to rejuvenate the water body, provided you are sensible and implement it, okay? So now, other thing is, wherever I come across the sensible people, they take my message forward, they create the thing. This gentleman met me. He had a 12 acres land. We identified where is the lowest point, how much water he can collect, and what are the benefits. See, the mangrove was undergoing a severe water stress. And this man immediately accepted that in 15 days, he implements that. And I found that this model is successful. It's because of the youth. He is young. And the youth of Alvar's college is there. And along with this one, I that this guy, Alvar's CEO, is also quite young. See, it's very easy to convince the youngsters. Now, the next talk is with this guy. Implement another lake in that region which stores 25 lakh liters of water. You know, in the campus, the water storage is 10 lakh liters. I stay on the campus. My family consumes 500 liters a day. That means 500 into 365 is about 1.5 lakh. At least 10 times higher water I am storing in that water body. If every Indian start doing this, 10 times what we consume, give it back to the system, there won't be any scarcity or poverty in the country. Okay? Now, we did this in 2017. The native species were planted here. Now, when I went there 2018, I see the water and also greenery with a smile on our face. Okay? Now, those who have not visited the campus, This is a climber, which I brought it from Western Ghats. When I saw this climber, I was so fascinated. I was a student at that time. I said I should have it in Bangalore, that in IIC campus. I got the seed, the campus, planted here in the 7 locations. You know that pod had 14 seeds. Out of 14 seeds in 7 locations I planted. And also keep in mind, this was planted by me when I was a student in 7 locations. Out of 7 locations, only one place it has survived, that is next to this building where I worked for the last 2 decades as a faculty. Even I didn't know that I will join the camp, I'll continue in IIC as a faculty, whereas this fellow knew that for sure I will continue in the campus. That's how the nature keeps, I knew. When you work with the, play with the numbers, please keep this also in mind so that you will be more successful in your life, okay? Now, what are the other advantages? In front of that building, I created the mini forest. You know, people like Madhav, Gadgil, the Saldana were there, the favorable environment. CNRO gave 2 hectares of land. We planted 49 species, 500 saplings. At that time, groundwater table was about 150 feet. Today, in that region, I have a water at 10 to 15 feet. Now, this is the model. If some place is facing the water crisis, you need to have the greenery. Now, quantitative data is there. I can prove that. Earlier, my statement, people used to laugh. But today, when this was told to the people, they are all convinced with that because I have the number associated with that. And also, I have 4 families of these slender lorries, okay? Now, this is a glimpse of the last symposium. And this is how the school children take part. You know, incidentally, there is a headed by this saint. We don't go behind the saint. But at the same time, I'm a strong believer. Science, society, and spirituality has to go hand in hand. See, what I have done, if I want to communicate to the last section of the common people, these saints are very useful. You know, I can talk to the 30 or 40 at a time, or 200 at a time, but these guys go up to 1,000, 5,000, 10,000 kind of thing. They are the effective ambassadors. That's what we do that. See, when we go to the school, we made him to plant, okay? Then my students are taking classes for the children. This is an orientation program. Now those children do the experiment. Those who have done extremely well, they come to our lake symposium. And they even won the prize, okay? And these are the simple experiments they do. See, when you look at this one, they measure the girth and height of a tree. You know, they will find out what is the carbon stored in the tree, okay? When they measure for the continuously for the 20 months, they will find out what is per year storage, okay? Then if the water body is there, the surrounding area catchment mapping they do, and also the water quality assessment they do. See, this, my student is explaining the kits. This is the froth in 2000. Today's froth is much higher. If you walk through, you will have a free wash. Anyway, it's a detergent, no, the froth. So, now take a difference of these 2 height. That gives the level of inefficiency in our system. Okay, now the kids go and collect the sample. They come to our lab, they do the analysis, and they draw the sketches. See, they learn. They got an opportunity to interact with the people in IISc at that young age. And some of them, who are from the rural area, today they have moved to the IITs as a faculty. At least we have identified the local rural youth and they have moved forward. Otherwise, there would have been another, the Chief Minister's various program of Bhagya. They also would have ended as one more farmer and would have committed suicide. But now at least we have changed that, okay? Now these are the sketches of this algae. And the people in the rural area, the children, they do their neighborhood mapping. You know, then we find out. The advantage is we'll know the diversity of the plants and animals in that village and the diversity of the humans. You know, I was surprised in one village I got 12 varieties of brinjal. You know, one is good for fragrance, other one is the size, and other one is for the yield, etc. If I hybridize it, I get a better product. I don't need a BT brinjal or that one. You know, these are the way we can manage the show with the indigenous, this one, okay? That is where I need to catch the youngsters and understand the local. Now, most of my students, these kids who have taken part, they don't want to leave their village. You know, at least we are trying to address the migration problem to the cities, okay? Now, my students are working on the diatoms. We are looking at the oil that comes out of the thing. At the same time, on the solar energy, see, this is the map which my student generated in 2009. Based on that, we have a solar program in the entire country. At the time, people said solar energy is not possible, 130 days, cloudy days. For the first time when we did this, especially we showed the thing, The government accepted that. That is where we came up with the generation-based incentive. That means if you have a rooftop, you generate electricity, feed it to the grid, you will get money to your account. Now, we are looking at this oil and how to convert this into the diesel. We are working on that. Of course, that work is in progress. So now, these are my areas of research and the teaching. I teach a course on remote sensing at IIC and also on environmental management. And also, other than that, I offer a course, which is a 16th batch now, is on environmental management and solid waste management. Okay? Now, these are all the people from army, industries, and universities. They take this course. About 40 or 50 of them come every year. Okay, this is the last batch. Now we have announced this course is for the 4 months during August to December. Okay? Now, if you want to know more, these are my location where you get the data. Related to biodiversity, you'll get here. If you want to do the spatial analysis at zero cost, free and open source softwares are archived at this location. And if you want to know more about my research, my group research, this is the web page you should be going. Now, when you access this web page, it looks like this. You get the details of the Lake Symposium and also some of the water testing labs I have created in Bangalore in various schools. That also you will get it. And you see the research paper section here. When you click on this, based on the various themes, we have archived the papers, okay? And similarly, related to lakes, we have the thing. We have about 1,000 publications today. Okay, my group's the last two decades, 1,000 papers than reports we have. Okay? If you have done a good job, it's because of these youngsters. Thank you very much.